Good afternoon. So continuing on the process of starting a tropical fruit tree forest in the Central Valley or in any climate where these guys should not grow at all. I mean, this is literally the definition of thriving. Etamoya, I mean, how many flowers can you possibly have per branch? I mean, this is literally after years and years of being in the ground. This is the definition of thriving. So if you don't want to propagate them from seeds, the next option really would be to get them from your tropical fruit tree nursery, or get them online if there is not any tropical fruit tree nurseries within a driving distance. That said, the online route, I've had varying levels of success. Luckily, with us in the Central Valley, I mean, it's really just a good maybe 3.5-4 hour drive for most of us down to the Los Angeles region. So it's really just maybe a day's trip. But I know some of you folks up in the Sacramento region, I'm aware maybe one or two tropical fruit tree nurseries up there, but they are within driving distance. So I will say that the cool thing with getting the tropical fruit trees through a local, I mean, through an actual tropical fruit tree nursery is the fact that you kind of get to see the different options that they have in person, and therefore allowing you to make the best selection out of the lot. So let me begin by saying one of the benefits of getting a tropical fruit tree from a nursery is the fact that generally the trees that they sell are either grafted or area units, which would mean the tree is fairly matured and generally within a year or even less, or even a couple of years, they generally start producing fruit for you. So in a sense, you're buying a couple of years. An example, okay, like check it out. Barbados cherry. Yeah, this guy, I purchased it last year. I want to say right around this time too. And look at how productive he is. It only been in the ground like a year. So yeah, I mean, most tropical fruit trees that you get from a nursery are gonna wanna start producing fruit the following year. Strange weather today on an unrelated note. It's been in the mid 60s, daytime. Tropicals aren't a fan of it, but it's great for you and I. There you go, my vitamin C for the day. So, again, you're getting a mature tree for the most part. That being the case, the idea too is the fact that these trees are technically hardier than seedling ones that you may germinate yourself when put in the ground. That said, it is my recommendation when at the tropical fruit tree nursery that you get a smaller unit. The trees are gonna come in varying sizes, up to like a 25-gallon container. Yeah, I mean, these go for hundreds of dollars with a tropical fruit tree that's in this container. In fact, let me show you. This was, I mean, look at the Pickering mango, okay? The cool thing is oftentimes they have the price mark there. on the container. Not every nursery does it, but the price is usually marked on the container. It's a 20-gallon container, but yeah, this is in some ways what you can expect to pay. Luckily, I got this on sale, so that's a price that's not the price that I pay for. But this is what I mean. This is what you're getting. I mean, he's fairly matured. I would guess based on the age to be maybe 4 years old. But yeah, I mean, the first things that they want to do is produce fruits for you. That's its goal in life. So that's one of the benefits. But again, it's been my experience, if you want to put these guys in the ground, get a smaller tree. Just because these guys grow crazy fast. Most tropical fruit trees go crazy fast. Granted, there are some exceptions, such as this booster lychee right here. Yeah, this guy is gonna take forever to grow, which I'm okay with, which is why I've got it situated right next to the other faster-ish growing trees. Yeah, so know the type of tree that you're getting and also the growth rate. So these are gonna be slow growing, as well as the miracle berry here. Yeah, that's gonna be a slower growing tree, okay? But again, I'm okay with getting a smaller unit. So now, that said, it's been my experience that about, I would say, close to, I say 90% of all the tropical fruit trees that I've had experience with are either medium growers or crazy fast grower. Suriname cherry is another great example. He's in the ground 5 years. The first year that he was in the ground, he really was no higher than maybe a foot tall. But yeah, I mean, that you can see he's pretty tall. So yeah, get the smaller containers. They generally cost a lot less as well. And also, it's been my experience too that the smaller trees, container trees, they have a slightly better time acclimating to our clay soil and our harsh environment, particularly winter time. Not sure why, but I attribute it to just like you getting a puppy versus getting an older dog. I mean, it's probably easier to train a puppy. Sounds mean, but I'm just saying that that's probably the saying. So get a smaller tree. So the next step is, once you get to the nursery, of course, you're probably going to be presented with like a number of selections of the same variety of tree. So let's go with the assumption that these are the exact same mangoes, okay? Same types of mangoes. The selection process that I would go about is get the tree with a larger trunk system. So that would mean out of the four here, this tree obviously great growth, awesome growth, new growth as well. New growth starting to bud out. Nah, it doesn't do anything. I would actually get this one just based on the fact that when you look at the size of the trunk that's attached to these rootstock, I mean, it's great. It is like big and plump, which would mean the root system is likely going to be better on this particular tree than the other tree. So what you want to do is once you get home, then just feed the heck out of it. It will have no problem growing. I mean, that's one of the consideration. I mean, the other stuff too is, of course, you want to look at the tree just to see if there's any diseases with it, anything that shows signs of the tree not being healthy looking. But That's one of the reasons why I personally prefer to be on site to pick out the trees that I want for our environment, just because given our crazy environment, really, you want the healthiest tree, the one that is going to be able to make it to winter, and more importantly, to summer. When the temperature gets 110 degrees during our summer days, your tree you're going to want the healthiest tree possible. That's not to say you shouldn't also give it some microclimate if possible. So yeah, that's how I would go about in selecting the best tree from the lot. So another consideration is you wanna, when you get to the nursery, of course, take your Instagram photos to show it off. That's critical. After that, you wanna take a mental note where they have the trees situated. For example, at the various nurseries in Los Angeles where I picked these guys up from, they were out in the full sun. Los Angeles sun, not Central Valley sun. When it's 110 here, it's generally about 80 degrees over there. So big difference, okay? So be mindful of where they've got the tree situated under. For example, if it was exposed to the full sun in the out open, if it's in a greenhouse where it's nice and humid, or if it's in their greenhouse, I'm not in in their shade cloth, for example. Now that said, it's been my experience about, I say about 80% of all the tropical fruit tree nurseries have theirs out in the open. There are some trees that I've noticed that they don't have them out in the open, and instead they generally have them shaded under a shade cloth of some sort. One of which is actually this guy right here. Starfruit, okay. Yeah, for some reason they have these underneath their shade canopy. And you've gotta realize it too. The vast majority of our tropical fruit trees come from the Florida region, which is literally on the other side of the state. And when they transport these in big semi trucks, total darkness in that enclosed trailer, okay? So the tree's not gonna see any sunlight for, I say, maybe like 3, 4 days. That's probably how long it takes to transport these to the West Coast. So yeah, for the most part, what the nurseries do is they actually put these in kind of a shaded environment for a few days to get them acclimated. You want to do the exact same thing when you get home. If you find a tree was placed in underneath a shaded environment at the nursery, do the exact same thing when you get home. And in fact, in my case, what I did actually to make sure this guy acclimated nicely in my climate was actually to put it underneath my gazebo, total shade, indirect sun, and then give it morning sun for a couple of hours for a few days, and then eventually left it out in this condition right here, where it is still mostly shaded during the afternoon harsh environment. So you're gonna want to try to mimic the location of the tree when you get home. So yeah, that's really it. So I'm gonna take you back in time to show you the more critical transportation process. So this is a part that the workers there are probably gonna help you with. So this is more for them, but in the event you need to do it yourself for whatever reason, then the loading process in your vehicle also makes a difference with the survival of the tree. I mean, again, just from most, for the most part, Central Valley to the LA region, you're talking a good 3.5-4 hour drive, okay? So, a long drive. If able to, put the newly purchased trees in a in an enclosed vehicle. If you've got like a flatbed truck, use a big tarp. Just make sure there's no airflow hitting the leaves, because last thing you want to do is have the trees go through like a hurricane wind. By the time you get home, the wind's going to be, I mean, the leaves are all gone and the trees like probably going to be half dead. So best option would be in an enclosed vehicle. So being that, again, my recommendation, small trees. This is one of the benefits of, if you come here, I'll show you actually. So check it out. Small tree, okay. Again, you probably just get a small tree. The best option really would be to have them standing up, just like so. Best option for the tree. Either that or get like a trailer, enclosed trailer. Yeah, works with practically all size vehicles. Just like so. Well, yeah. So now, the other option is if you can't, if the tree is too tall, then you're gonna wanna put it in the trunk. The workers are likely gonna tilt this and put it this way. And then it is gonna be your responsibility to try to secure it as much as you can, because this guy is gonna roll around. So secure it. And for the most part, you're probably gonna buy a few of these. So it's gonna be stacked on top of one another. So, but again, try your best to secure it if you can. Works on small cars as well. Pull down the seats, for the most part. Pop it in. Just like so. Again, secure it. So once you get home, take your restroom break, and then the first thing that you want to do is take out the plastic, which the workers there will likely wrap it up for you, so that way it retains all the soil and the wood chip. Take it out, water it thoroughly. That's one of the first things you should do, is water it thoroughly. What it does is, these guys are stressed enough by having laid on the side, and also the vibration of your vehicle. It's not a smooth ride, but the vibration of the vehicle causes the soil to be kind of dislodged, and you're essentially disturbing the roots. So by watering it, it kind of calms these guys down. So yeah, that's really the gist of it.